How do you ensure that this agreement doesn't compromise the country's interests? And which country do you think should take custody of Japanese soldiers committing crime on Philippine soil?
I cannot see how the reciprocal agreement would affect any of that. It essentially talks about Japan allows us to make ports of call in Japan and vice versa. How it will possibly affect the issue about comfort women and the what allegations that are made against war criminals during the Second World War. I cannot see how it will bleed into that. I think it's quite distinct and discreet in its effect.
About the custody, sir.
About the
custody
of
erring Japanese servicemen on Philippine soil. Which country do you think should take custody of these Japanese servicemen in case RAA is approved?
Oh. It's not the same as a visiting forces agreement. That's not similar. The visiting forces, we've had problems with that with the Americans, some American forces, as we all know. It's very, very different from what the reciprocal agreement will be with the Japanese. It's not going to be as if it's their base and their seamen will come down and will go into the city and go into. Well, I don't think that that's a part of the agreement.
Thank you
so much. May we have Mara Cepeda of the Straits Times, please?
Hello, Mr. President.
Hello.
Sir, you already reiterated the position of the Philippines regarding the ICC.
Yes.
And so, sir, I raised the issue of the Philippines advocating for an international rules-based order. We're pushing for it when we are resisting Beijing's aggressive actions against the Philippines in the West Philippine Sea. But we are opting out of the Rome Statute when an adverse case has been lodged against us. So, sir, is the rules-based order only applicable to the Philippines when it's convenient for us?
What is the rule about the ICC? When do they adopt jurisdiction? They adopt jurisdiction in a country, or they have jurisdiction in a country when no judicial system is working, is functioning, no police no police force is functioning. In other words, that probably there is war. And none of these issues about war crimes and all of this are being attended to, simply because the administration, especially in the judiciary, especially in law enforcement, are not functioning. That is the reason why we are saying we are well within the rules. It is their rule. It is the rule of ICC that they come in when there is no judiciary. They come in when there is no police force. We have a judiciary. The Chief Justice, the former Chief Justice, sitting right here. He will explain to you how healthy and robust and active the judiciary is. The police force, I think, the same thing. So that is the reason. It is not. We are well within international law when we take the position of not recognizing the jurisdiction of ICC in the Philippines. Mm-hmm.
One follow-up, sir. So yeah. if the ICC issues an arrest warrant against former President Duterte, will the Philippine government hand him over?
Will we do what?
Will the Philippine government hand him over if the ICC...
We don't recognize the warrant that they will send to us.
So that's a no?
That's a no.
Thank you, sir.
Regine Cabato of the Washington Post, please.
Good afternoon, Mr. President. Last week, you said that you were horrified at the prospect of a gentleman's agreement between former President Duterte and China.
Wouldn't you be?
Of course.
I think we all should, right?
Mm-hmm. And you said as well, Mr. President, that he should be held accountable. And since then, experts have said that any such agreement compromising PH sovereignty or territory would be a violation of not just the 2016 arbitral ruling, but Philippine law. So my question for you, sir, is how do you intend to hold former President Duterte accountable? Are there any actions being taken on this front?
Well, we we still have to find out what it is all about. We cannot. I've tried to get in touch with former officials of the previous administration who could possibly have been involved in these discussions. And I have to tell you, I haven't gotten a straight answer out of anyone. Now, one party says, one person says, there's no agreement. Another person says, no, there was talk, but it's only status quo. No, there was, and another one will say, there was an agreement. So I'll go back to the three questions that I asked when this came, when this subject came up. Number one, the first question I want answered is, was there an agreement in fact? I think by now we can see that in fact there was a secret agreement, and the what verifies that and what I think for me at least convinces me that there was in fact a secret agreement is the insistence of the Chinese government that there was a secret agreement. I do not think the Chinese government, I don't think Beijing will just make up and just out of nowhere say there was a secret agreement when there was no such thing. All right, so I think to my mind that is sufficient to me to prove to me that there was such an agreement. The second question I need answered is what is contained in that secret agreement? What did we agree to? And why did we agree to them, to that? What exactly is it that we compromised? Number two. Number three, and this is a critical question, why did you keep it secret? Why is there not one single document that contains that agreement? Why is there not one shred of evidence that can show that this agreement exists? Why, when we the transition period between the previous administration to this administration, did no one mention a secret agreement? Why was it kept secret? These are very simple questions, but I'm finding a great deal of difficulty finding answers for them. Because I hear one thing and another thing and another thing and another thing, it's all very maraming palusot. In other words, I don't know how to translate that in English, but maraming palusot.
Let me add a fourth question to that, Mr. President. What happens if you find out that there might be a legal liability on the part of former President?
I cannot see how there could possibly be a legal liability. There is no evidence of any agreement.
Okay.
Is there a document that is signed? I'd love to see it. Mm-hmm. You know, it does not affect the Philippines. And if there is, I have said that before. When this first came up a few months ago, and they said it turns out that the Chinese are insisting that there's a secret agreement, and perhaps there is. And I said, I don't know anything about the secret agreement. Should there be such a secret agreement, I am now rescinding it. So I've rescinded it, if indeed it exists. We are so far from getting to the truth, to the nub of the thing. We are so far away from it yet that it's very hard to give a reaction to those questions. Let's get those three questions answered. We've answered the first one. Now, what is contained in that secret agreement, and why was it kept secret? Those are the two questions left. Once we get those three answers, real answers, then we will know what to do.
Just a quick follow-up, Mr. President. You also said last week that you found the silence of Vice President Sara Duterte understandable, even as her family members have attacked you lately. And some analysts have even said that the family is out to undermine your policy. How would you describe your relationship with the Duterte family currently? And how would you reconcile your continued allyship with the Vice President and her family's vocal disdain for your policy?
It's complicated.
Okay.
All right. It's complicated. But if you ask about the one, of course, that I have the most contact with is Inday Sara. and how we were with each other during the campaign, after the election, after, no, it hasn't really changed. That's what she always says. She said, oh, are you all right now? You're in the middle of all of this. And she says, no, I'll just work. Don't worry about it. I'll just work and work and work and work. That's her attitude.
All right. Thank you so much for answering very candidly, Mr. President.